Ekholm, who is the Director General of the European Organisation for Research and Treatment of Cancer, based here in Brussels. Denis Lecombe received his MD from the University of Marseille, and then he performed research in pharmacology and pharmacokinetics at the Roswell Park Cancer Centre in the US. He joined the ERTC in 1993 and rose to Director of Headquarters in 2010. He was appointed Director General in 2015. In his current role, he is involved in coordination of all activities of the ERTC to promote the ERTC as a major European organization in cancer clinical trials and translational research. And today, he can give us a unique view of a large academic sponsor running international multi-center clinical trials from their headquarters here in Brussels.
So good morning, everyone. Thank you to the KCE for the invitation. So it's my pleasure indeed to present to you the activities of the ORTC. So I try to present that, of course, from the sponsor angle. And as you can see, I have added to the proposed title the word international, because just to introduce to you the ORTC, for those of you that are less familiar with the organization, actually it's a large network. We have a 50 plus year of existence. We operate across 37 countries. I just would like to point out that the activities actually are performed through the 21 different disease-oriented groups like breast cancer, lung cancer, and so on. Yes, of course, the organization is only dedicated to cancer clinical research, so my presentation will be, of course, very much biased towards our learnings in oncology. But maybe also what is important to mention for the messages I'm going to pass is that we have a large intergroup collaboration, so our clinical trials are not only performed by the ORTC, but we have a cooperation with national groups and other national groups, and as of today we have more than 100 collaborators over the years. Just to give you an idea also on the volumes, at any point in time we have about 50 clinical trials running. The turnover is about 20 clinical trials every year, so we close and open 20. And if you imagine that each of these clinical trials have about an average of 15 to 20 sites in 10 countries, you make the multiplication and you realize the volume of regulatory affairs if you include the process of amendments, pharmacovigilance and reporting, because at any point in time we follow roughly 200 clinical trials. So it's relatively big volume. I think before I go in the presentation, I think that it's important, at least for oncology, to realize what is coming up, because that's a vision of the evolving research pathway. You will realize, for instance, that in this slide I have suppressed all notion to phase one, phase two, and phase three, because I think this is more or less obsolete terminology. I prefer to refer to trial design to learn, some sort of trial design to conclude, and then all the real-life pragmatic trials. So I think we have reshaped actually our activities as an academic sponsor around this vision. And sometimes what I realize is that in the academic field or non-commercial field, things takes a lot of time to change, and we don't follow the pace of industry. And though I realize the symposium focused on pragmatic trials, so on the right hand side of this Diabolo shape, I think we see the shape, the clinical trial that we are doing today, changing very fast, and to some extent more and more technology based. And I believe that these technology based clinical trial will also be pragmatic trials. Will also affect the type of pragmatic trial that we are doing, and I will come with some example later on. So I think it's important to understand also the changes, and actually as ERTC, we are active also in development knowledge, in very early on type of clinical research, but also in pragmatic trial, because we want really to build a new continuity solution that spans from proof of concept to effectiveness. And I think it's more and more difficult to dissociate research and care, but also knowledge development and effectiveness to some extent. So I think the borders are no longer so so clear. So with this, what I would like to cover, and I realize I am the last obstacle before your lunch, is a little bit setting the scene. So when you initiate a clinical trial, what is the difference between national and international trial? We refer to independent academic trial, and I think what is important when we get started is to know the battlefield, because if you don't know the battlefield, you cannot win the battle. And I think what I will cover with you is issues and based on example, and I will try to use examples that are drug clinical trials but also non-drug clinical trials. So everything that is related to feasibility of international trial, issues with all the regulations, legal, including insurance, which we had a question this morning, but also all the operational issues, such as drug supplies in a multi-language setting, but also, of course, budgeting and funding. Then we will go into conducting of the study with some of the aspects that you see listed there, and also documentation and management of filing, trial master file, which are so critical if you want to be able to document your findings. Something that is extremely, I would say, alerting, and there are more and more literature about this, is the reproducibility of academic research. And I think we have to be extremely vigilant, and Frank Ulstar this morning referred to people doing clinical trial in Excel sheet and these type of things, and we have to be extremely cautious because this gives very bad publicity to independent research. And then, of course, as developed by Dr. Mush, we have to look into the future, because we are facing, again, a series of change. So I think what in setting the scene when you start an international clinical trial, I think national versus international, nothing compares, and I will give you an example of a TIGER trial, of the TIGER trial. And also what we see when we discuss and we set up clinical trial with national groups across Europe is that they believe actually that the national, they assume that a European expertise come from the sum of their national expertise, and that's not the case at all. It requires additional skills, and again, completely different type of magnitude of such as infrastructure, IT, clinical trial management system, and solution. And I think it's very important to always assess what are the needs versus the deliverable. If you want to do an exploratory, just finding proof of concept, maybe you can do locally, very, I would say, between bracket and with no pejorative connotation, amateuristically. But when it comes to regulation, to reimbursement, to adapting access, I think we need absolutely a solid basis. And that's why sometimes it's confusing, because we are referred to academic, non-commercial, IIT, pragmatic trial, public health trial, and there is a lot of confusion across this trial. I think what we like to do at the ORTC, and we have proudly delivered practice-changing trials over the years, and some of the current standards of treatment in oncology comes from our clinical trial, is really to be a trusted body, because we want the data to be implementable reliably into the general patient population. So I think it's important also in the context of publicly funded trial to really realize what do we want as a deliverable, and then define the methods of operation. So one example, so as you can see, this one is a drug-based trial. The design is not important. It's just to show you that it's a trial that is addressing high-dose chemotherapy in refractory germ cell tumor. And the beauty of this trial is that there is a global, worldwide consensus that this trial is needed. So because also we have the capacity to organize global trial with the US, with Canada, Korea, Japan, and Australia, this trial was started, and actually this trial is operated from the US, and initially was supposed to be activated in Europe through the various national groups, and it failed. And that's where I'm referring to the fact that the sum of the expertise is not necessarily a European expertise. So basically, the organizer came back to the ORTC, and now we are organizing this trial, and after about a year of work, we are announcing the opening of the first European site. So it requires a lot of skills and a lot of expertise, and this trial is probably one of the most complex trials, because in addition to the European difficulties, we have to import the regulation from the US that impose on us some part and of their regulation to accept European sites on the trial. So I think that's this type of trial that are really practice changing that we want to make happen, because they will be meaningful to the patients. I think when we get started also, and that was a good example because it was absolutely not disputed by the various research groups, but we see of course many situations where it's not that easy. For instance, especially in very rare tumors where there are sometimes not the same standard, there have been no active clinical research to agree for a control arm. The acceptability of the design, I will show you an example of the LORD trial. The operational feasibility, I just mentioned SURTIME, which is a trial where the PI who designed, who thought about a study in the neoadjuvant treatment of kidney cancer, had planned 48 hours between for access to surgery, which was not feasible in an international setting, which we had to readjust. So I think these are these type of things that we have to anticipate, or also access to facilities and standard of care. For instance, we have in some instances, long-term follow-up type of clinical trial where we want to understand actually, for instance, to capture some of the relapse and, for instance, access to imaging or access to specific procedure may not be in the standard practice from between country to country to country. So I think we have to understand that when we set up pragmatic trial. So just to give you an example of the LORD trial, which I think is currently a trial in activation, which is exactly the type of trial we are meant to do as an academic organization. It's breast cancer, DCIS, grade 1. Well, is it a cancer? It's a very early stage, and basically it's a very large clinical trial that is planned to last for 10 years until maturity, where ladies will be randomized between getting surgery or living in place. You can imagine the challenge. So I will go, in the interest of time, very rapidly over the eligibility criteria, which require, despite being a very pragmatic trial, what I think is a very pragmatic trial addressing day-to-day questions, how these ladies should be addressed, require a quite high level of coordination. And again, here we are in a non-drug trial. I wanted to have different type of example, but again, the difficulty is obtaining signed informed consent, and we already anticipated a lot of different cultural differences across Europe. So this is this part of challenges that we have in these pragmatic clinical trial, public health type of question, where sometimes in a multicultural environment there are challenges. Again, important to know the battle if we want to know the battlefield, if we want to win the battle. Now, coming to the regulatory and the legal aspect, here also we have been the second sponsor in Europe and the first academic sponsor to use the voluntary harmonization procedure, which is some sort of embryo of the regulation that is coming up, by which you have a common approach of the various member states to get clearance for a clinical trial. But you have to go again according to a procedure by which there is a clock start, clock stop, depending on the question you receive. And this requires really a professional and centralized, infrastructure with regulatory people that can manage this type of procedure. And Dr. Musch has emphasized in her presentation that in the regulation there will be no difference between commercial and non-commercial trial. So I think we need to professionalize. And when it comes to ethics committees, of course we see the huge variability. in their varying operation, varying requirements, and insurance. Professor Bouillon asked this morning the question about insurance. I can tell you I've been at the URTC for 20 years. When I started, actually I did set up the insurance program of the URTC in the early 90s. We started with three insurance policies. Today we have at any time about 170 policies ongoing. So just with the financial impact that you can imagine. So it's a constant reassessment of this evolution and of the regulatory environment and how you adapt. Again, why we have been the we have the capacity to do that? Because basically we are a central CTU in Europe. And we have this vision, and we have the capacity to coordinate that, which I think is much more difficult from several different type of sponsors that are being coordinated after a certain number of countries is needed. Maybe for two, three countries it's feasible, but behind it starts to be extremely difficult. Then comes to some of the operational aspects that I would like to develop with you. I can tell you that today, if you are an academic sponsor and you open a clinical trial, and even if the drugs are registered in the indication, you may be and you are requested in the vast majority of the cases to provide or to pay or whatever the investigational medicinal product, even if it's an optimization strategy type of trial. So I think it's very complex, it's very expensive, you need to coordinate your delivery, you need to organize your labels in multi-language, and this is the case also for the patient information sheet. And a change in the protocol in this country will impact as it's a single protocol in this other country, will impact on the patient information sheet in the neighboring country, which has to be updated and so on, with all the version control that you need to maintain, because we are, of course, subject as normal to any inspection and any audit. Something that also in modern oncology actually is critical is the need to collect biological material, because we have technology-based clinical trial, and I think sometimes there is an overestimation of virtual biobanking. We have abandoned virtual biobanking because basically you cannot maintain the quality requirement that is requested by various regulations. And also when you go back to your collection, basically you get 20% back, and that's completely unethical. So I think this is important for our commitment to patients that we ensure an appropriate storage and future use of biological material. Something that is new also is the data sharing capacities and processes for doing so. You know that data sharing is now will become mandatory, so we need to have procedure, we need to have access of the data at any time. And something also that we don't see in place in various academic sponsors we collaborate with are business continuity plans. And now we are going to request business continuity plans, because we have been exposed to sponsors, academic sponsors we collaborate with, and whatever happened in their at their sites, and then it's difficult to access to the data because a problem happened, or a fridge where the samples have been located was down, and so on. And this, of course, is not happening in the commercial environment, but is happening in the academic environment. And that, of course, we have to to rectify. So I think at any point in time, we are asking to the collaborators we work with is to have an auditable set of SOPs and, of course, as per international standard, including a business continuity plan. Otherwise, we have a lot of difficulty to collaborate, again, because what we want to deliver has to be potentially changing practice, and we have to demonstrate. Now, coming to budgeting, I think, again, the finality of the data justify the means. It depends what you want in, what you want out. An infrastructure like the ORTC, we are all often say you are more expensive than if I do the trial in a university or in a small network. Yes, indeed, internationality has a cost, and if you need a solid infrastructure, it has a different cost. All depends what you want out of it. I think there are generally an underestimation of resources needed for international coordination, an underestimation of the cost what I call pass-through cost related to insurance. We discussed that. On-site monitoring, what we call ICOMS, which is the investigator compensation, drug supply, and so on. So something that we have also as a bottleneck when we start discussing budgeting with national group, they say, okay, you are going to join, that's €1,000 per patient that we give you, but doesn't mean anything in an international setting, because you have such so many setups to start, that we have a budget that, for instance, the fixed cost, those that you need to start an international cooperation, then we have a per patient cost, then we have this pass-through cost, and then we have the investigator cost. So I cannot enter in the detail of the budgetings, of course, but it's just to tell you that also the approach of budgeting that we do, as opposed to what do most of the nationals today, is different. Funding, of course, that's the struggle. The problem is that European call rarely meet the needs that we have at the time we want. National funds remain in the countries, and of course there are challenges to coordinate international funding. In the interest of time, I will just show you a couple of examples. For instance, this is a platform that we have launched 3 years ago for quality assurance in surgery, because there is no prospective clinical research in surgery. So obviously, it's not funded by any commercial. We cannot find money. And then we are going, for instance, to the leagues or to various national fundings, and it is extremely difficult to coordinate. When everybody recognizes that it's a need in the oncology field, to get the funding to do this platform is extremely complex. And that's the network of SureCare that we are doing, which, as you have seen, include Japan. The trial, which probably will be a success, at least I hope, is that that we are discussing with the CACE and the NIHR, is to do a trial that will address the duration of immunotherapy in melanoma. You know that these new drugs are skyrocket for their cost. And I think that's a trial we want to make happen, and that we are discussing in this coordination of funding. And I think it's the first time we are exposed to such prospective discussion, and I hope we are going to make it happen. But you see the difficulty of coordinating a number of different European funders. I would just like to take a few minutes, because I've introduced you to the Diabolo, where I told you that things are changing. And for instance, the question that we are addressing about immunotherapy in melanoma, I think, is already very late. The drugs are on the market, patients receive it. I think we have to change completely the way we are doing research, and that's why this pragmatic trial should come much earlier. Because what we see currently in the landscape is basically companies developing their drugs, putting them on the market, so certainly discussing with the payers and so on to try to make things happen and rapidly to the market. But the question that we have in pragmatic trials are there, is how are we going to use these drugs? And if we take this question too long, the science is changing so fast that it's too late. So I think we have to rethink completely our models and bring this question much earlier during drug development, and we need to reinvent our world for that. So conducting the study, I will be very fast because I realize I am beyond my time. Quality assurance programs are varying. Most of the difficulty also is with the pharmacovigilance reporting, how you do reporting SAE, producing yearly DSURs. Risk-benefit was mentioned, also something that the academics don't know how to assess, and also having risk-based plans, which we have at the ORTC already for a number of years. This is my last slide. I would like to call it Back to the Future. because actually there is not one regulation coming back that Dr. Mush has introduced to us, but there are two others regulation. There is the IVD regulation and there is the data protection regulation. And the problem is that they all will all impact on the conduct of clinical trial, but they are inconsistent in many ways. So we are going to be faced with problem. That's why I say we are back to 2004 when we saw the implementation of the directive. We are at the heart of a European setup where the DG Research, DG Grow, and the DG Justice maybe did not collaborate enough. Here we are. So we are addressing that currently very actively. But just to say that you don't improvise yourself as an academic sponsor. You need really, really a professional infrastructure. And maybe a number I should have given to you is that at the ORTC headquarters, currently we have a team of 10 people that just take care of all these regulatory aspects for the volume of trial that I have indicated to you. With this, I would like to thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. I just had one small question regarding informed consent. You mentioned that it's difficult to get informed consent in a multicultural environment. Would you be surprised to elaborate?
Yes, because you have one central protocol, but of course, obviously, the various versions of the patient information sheet that you are using will diverge because of the language, but also because of the different requirements. Just to give you a recent example, which will give me also the opportunity to tell you about the inconsistency that we see coming, is that, for instance, an ethics committee somewhere in Europe that anticipates, that have probably a very strange understanding of data protection, has forbidden that the data of the patient be shared, of their patient, of their institution be shared. So on one hand, you have, for instance, data sharing requirements that are coming, but on the other hand, you have a data protection, and this is implemented like this at an ethics committee. So this means that if we want this site to participate, we have to remove all data sharing articles in the informed consent related to that, and the data of this site will have to be handled separately in future projects. So this is the type of inconsistencies we see.
So, can you enlighten us on turnaround times for clinical trials?
Yes, well, of course, if you do a national trial, I guess it depends. It's relatively fast. For us, in our environment, if I take from the study concept to the first site activation, it's about 15 months. If you take from the end of the protocol until the activation of the sites, we have very efficient countries currently where we can start in 3 months, but we have other countries where it lasts more than 1 year, for instance, because in addition to that, you have some specific national regulation. For instance, in Germany, if you use radiation or this type of thing, you have to go through specific radiation commission that take quite a lot of time. So it's very varying, but okay, the best we can do in terms of purely regulatory process is 3 months. That's why we tend also to select sites and centers. For efficiency reasons, sometimes.
Thank you, Johan Gunster, former head of the Belgian Medicines Agency. I have a question with regard to these combination therapies. You've spent some slide on that, but I presume that you're primarily dealing with this type of approach. How do you deal then from a regulatory point of view? How do you deal with it with the sponsors? Because there are so many.
So, for instance, the type of the trial I've shown you in testis cancer is multiple drugs. They are all available. There is nothing investigational. Obviously, it's an It's a dose intensification, which is the question. So we have to a little bit play with the application because they are not meant for this type of trial. Yes, that's another difficulty. A lot of things is prepared for drug development for industry type of trial. So we constantly have to adapt and be imaginative. So in that type of trial, we would plead that the investigational part is the intensification, and we would do the form, the application form based on the intensification, and voila, and we activate according to this basis. And then you have you can be exposed to completely different questions indeed, because this type of trial are you of course is not the type of trial that competent authorities sometimes or ethics committee are used to, which is a drug development company type of trial. But I think what something which was good in the clinical trial directive is that it has improved the visibility of non-commercial trials since the last 10 years. And I think we see more and more extremely, I would say, competent authorities. If I can say so. So I think but also what we have learned is to professionalize, because as I try to explain, we need to become much more professional. But I believe in 2004, the vast majority of the academics were not professional, but we constantly need to professionalize. And here we have other challenges where, again, it requires, there is no place for amateurism unless you want to have a small hypothesis in your lab with a few patients to be done. But that's not the type of activity I guess we are discussing here, where funders or publicly the public funders want to adapt some I would say guidelines and access for populations.